Thanks, Exhibition India group, for having this panel. And I'd like to invite Mr. Manojit Bose, CKO, Chief Knowledge Officer for Pune Smart Cities, on the stage. Sorry. And we have Rasik also there, who's from Get My Parking. We would request Shashank Agrawal from Sangam Ventures, and Mr. Devang Mehta, partner with Anthill Ventures also.
So just to start the discussion, I'd request you, sir, to give a brief on what you've been leading and what are your, you know, thoughts on smart city overall in India, and where are we? As a, you know, layman, I would love to have the concept actually taking shape and be living in a city like that. But how far are we? Is it a dream right now? And since you're leading it in Pune, where are we on that?
Yeah, thanks for, you know, kind of giving me this opportunity to share my views. So, a smart city's journey, I mean, it started around 3-4 years back, and different cities have progressed on their, you know, in their own ways. More specific to Pune smart city, I mean, you know, we certainly did what several other smart cities were doing, which is in terms of building up the command and control structure and installing the IoT devices and integrating applications with the command and control center and all of that. But over the last 7-8 months, what we have tried to do is basically focus more on data, focus more on innovation, right? And in doing that, we probably are the only smart city in the country today which has started making endeavors. So, you know, just to give you an example, I mean, in the month of April, we just concluded our 5th hackathon. And this hackathon, the 5th one, was with the European Union. And it was about development of IoT applications based on 1M2M standards. Each of these hackathons have been received very well. We got phenomenal participation, not only from people wanting to come and participate, but as well from, you know, the government agencies, from our partners. Now, the unique thing in the hackathon which we did in the month of April was, as compared to the previous hackathons, right? I mean, when we used to provide data to the participating teams through, you know, through an email in the form of an Excel spreadsheet, we are probably, again, the only smart city in the country where the India Urban Data Exchange, an initiative of the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, to basically bring about a concept of a data broker, if you will, that has been integrated with our command and control center. And today, in course of the 5th hackathon, all the data, including the data of the environmental sensors, was made available to the participating teams through open APIs. There was absolutely no manual intervention. So we have been trying to do some of these you know, initiatives, because we also believe, right, that smart cities are a very, very complex ecosystem at a ground level. And there are no organizations today which has a solution which fits into the entire gamut of things. There are a lot of white spaces. And these white spaces are the ones where, with the data which is available and with all the emerging technologies which we, you know, keep on listening about, which we keep on talking about, there's an opportunity for somebody to really think out of the box, come and solve some specific problems. So that's the direction we have undertaken. And we believe that for smart cities to evolve in India, once you're done with the basics, right? Basics in terms of the technology infrastructure, I'm not even getting into the physical infra here. Once you're done with the basics, you should be focusing and spending a lot of time on how data can be leveraged. Now, you may not have the best of data in the world, right? For that to happen, it will take still some more years. Whatever you have, start analyzing it, throw the data open, allow the young minds and brains to come to the table with their out-of-box ideas, provide them with implementation opportunities. At least then, slowly over a period of time, you will realize maybe in the next 3-5 years,
people will be completely talking in a different lingo. What is heartening is, in the last few years, I have seen this transition from the government as a buyer talking about the big organizations to now at least people are talking about startups. They are talking about data. Hopefully in the next 5 years, there will be a huge transition. Yeah.
Very, very encouraging to see, I guess, the government talking about it. And you know, we have so many startups here in the room also who are focused on, you know, getting a better city and a smart city in place. So that's, yeah. Devang, coming in from Anthill Ventures, so can you share what your views are on smart city overall, and from an investor's perspective, how do you look at, you know, B2G, you know, sorry, you know, customers coming in from, you know, government, and how do you, you know, overall, how do you take the government to be as the paymasters? Do you see it as a threat, or your views there?
So, Anthill Ventures is a premier fund accelerator based in India and Singapore. We invest in early stage companies at pre-Series A and Series A and help scale them by giving them market access, mentorship, and other you know, ways to scale, essentially. Now, smart cities, I think the question was around smart cities. I don't think any VC says they're a smart city investor. It's not a vertical. I think it's usually at the intersection of IoT, clean tech, urban tech, mobility, and mobile, you know, broadly speaking. And some combination of those constitutes an investment thesis, and that aligns usually with smart city startups. So it's a good growth area. I think there's a lot of exciting innovation that is at all levels, and it permeates the government, industry, academia, startups, VCs, PE players, and everything. So all that is good. I think selling into the government is always challenging. It's no joy in India, especially. So when we look at startups, if the startup is predicated only on selling into the government, it's frankly a little bit of a red flag in India. Any startup that has a mixture of private industry and government as the customer mix, that's more palatable. And aside from that, I think broadly, I think it's a great area of growth. I think there's a lot of direction from different levels of government, but it's not been implemented in the pace that most people desire. But one has to be optimistic.
Of late, you know, as IN also, we've been dealing with government and on payments and things, but the things are changing. So that is something, you know, we can, because I see that, you know, smart city concept overall at the beginning stage where we are right now as a nation, you know, government has to contribute. Otherwise, the wheels don't get start rolling, and that will be an issue. Shashank, your views, please, on this.
Hi, I'm Shashank from Sangam Ventures, and we invest in clean tech and agri-tech startups up to pre-Series A and Series A. And we also run an accelerator based out of Delhi and Bangalore. And we basically coach startups to get to product market fit and raise institutional investment and help them get access to stakeholders and people that they need to work to get there, and also that acts as a feeder to the fund. Having said that, we do have, so more, maybe this is not just a problem just around the smart city, but dealing with government is something that is kind of been there for quite a while, and a lot of startups, like Devang said, like come with B2G as their only revenue or with a major chunk of their revenue, and that's a red flag because A, it's a very unpredictable process. It's either you hit it or you miss it. You cannot basically base your model or your entire revenue on the government. Government changes every 5 years. There are state elections, central elections. Then there are transfers of the stakeholders in the middle. You're talking to somebody, that guy gets transferred. And so bureaucracy is also there. So what I would say is that for any startup which is irrespective of smart city or whether which is plugging into the smart city or otherwise, needs to kind of focus on the customer and needs to focus on the problem that they're solving. Government can be an enabler, but not the sole customer or the person on the back of which you basically build a business. And government policy, again, is often like this. Me and Devang were kind of discussing earlier in the morning, the policy is actually made by people who themselves were not entrepreneurs. They were probably having some jobs and experts, or they were doing R&D, and then they're making policies for startups or enabling startups. So that sometimes is not in sync with what really the startup needs. So which is why the startup should ideally kind of figure out plan Bs, or make the plan B the plan A and not have probably the government as their sole customer or the sole person to whom they are dealing with, or the sole stakeholder.
So Rasik from, Rasik is running a startup which is called Hit My Parking. So how, agreeable are you to this discussion, in the sense the government, what kind of a support have you got in getting your startup moving, in getting some numbers coming in from the government revenue perspective?
Sure, Digvijay. Before I get on to that, let me give a brief description about what Get My Parking is on what do we do. So Get My Parking is a smart parking startup, but we are more focused B2B as our business. We provide an interoperable platform which can digitize everything that goes inside a parking lot, all the equipments, whatever machinery, entry gates, payment stations, payment gateways. We connect all of them, integrate all of them, and we make all of that accessible to all the stakeholders like government, facility management companies, property management companies, and parking operators. And of course, mobility companies. So as rightly said by so many of our panelists here, we are not solely dependent only on government to do our business. We have the best smart parking platform which can integrate end-to-end complete parking experience. And we see that the product, if it's that strong, then you can have different verticals which can complement each other. So government sales cycle is more like an elephant, where you would want it's okay if you get only one elephant, if you can hunt one in 1 year, that's okay. But at the same time, you would want to hunt smaller fishes, smaller ticket size projects, but with a higher frequency in some another vertical. So we have enterprise customers, parking operators, not only in India, but in 16 countries now all over the world. And we rely mostly on them for our financial stability and growth. And government business has its own pros and cons, I will say, for a startup, because the entry barrier is so high for a startup to get into it, that once you do, then you know that it will be that high or even more difficult for other competitors as well. So it's difficult to crack, but if you keep on it and you crack it, then it also gives you really high competitive advantage. That's one. Second advantage I see with government business is that you are slowly, you become an influencer of sorts as a thought leader in the policy making in the country. I am invited along with some other entrepreneurs that I know in the smart city space several times for discussions on policy making. Our panelist Manojit Bose said about UIDX platform. So I remember last year I was invited in the preliminary workshop where some of entrepreneurs were able to give their contribution on how UIDX platform for India should be built and how it should benefit startups also. So there are some advantages.
We can see that government is also trying to look for solutions and to break out of their shell of, that they're slow, they take time to, disperse the money and, contracts. I think we can see that change coming in. Like you said that, you are invited.
Right, right.
Investors are invited similarly to, any policy decision making.
But Digvijay, regarding the money part, the money does come late. So what advice?
But it's confirmed. You know, they say late, so, aega, but you know, it is for sure.
But what I can give as an advice to other fellow entrepreneurs is that try to ride on the shoulders of giants. You know, maybe become a vendor or a supplier or a partner to someone big enough who can take that liability and risk on their books, like system integrators.
The smart city overall concept, I think if the government is, you know, they're thinking about it, they're wanting to implement it, but I feel that, you know, without their support, this will not be initiatives like basic health, you talk about, you know, mobility, you talk about so many other things which have to be primarily been driven by the government in order to, you know, us coming back later and, you know, supporting startups and overall, you know, for some government. So what is there in, you know, Pune that is a little different from, and how do you feel has the government actually gone ahead and supported you in ways more than one, or, you know, you is it just at the talk level there?
No. So, you know, the government and we both are the same. So, I represent the special purpose vehicle, which is the government entity running the implementation of the smart city. And, you know, as I said, the awareness is happening. People are now looking at startups and how data can be leveraged for problem solving. Yeah, so there are two things, right? I mean, so in course of the hackathons which we have done, there is one particular startup which came up with a very unique proposition on, you know, running analytics on the raw CCTV camera footages of the Pune police. So that startup has been provided with an opportunity and they are doing really very well in that. So those are the kind of opportunities which we try to provide to the startups so that they're at least able to demonstrate. So we may not be able to give them any, you know, kind of revenue or any straight away, the, you know, the business part. But what also happens is when you have worked with, say, one smart city, even if it is on a no-cost basis, that becomes your calling card when you go to the other smart cities. And, you know, when you go to the other smart cities and talk about, there's absolutely, so you know, that helps. Having said that, we are also trying to, you know, kind of work out policies by virtue of which, you know, certain amount work orders can be big, but a small amount work orders can be straight away given to the startups based on that. Yeah. So you know, that is something which is, you know, happening. So, you know, there are different layers of approval which it has to go through. Additionally, what we have done quite differently is that for all the technology RFPs that we have floated, we have included one very important, you know, kind of thing in that. And that is, if any master system integrator partners with a startup, he's going to be getting some additional scores when the technical evaluation is done. So that has set, you know, the MSIs and the SIs looking for startups as a potential technology partner when they come up with their solutioning to, you know, in response to our RFPs and all. And we are also saying that suppose it is an ATMS RFP, whosoever is the master system integrator, he not only has to do a hackathon based on all the data from the traffic sensors which will be captured, but they also have to invest in you know, kind of bringing in data scientists, data analysts and all to the table for the government. So the point is, you're not only going to be deploying the solution, we are asking you to partner with a startup, you will get some additional scoring points, you will be asked to run a hackathon with all the data which you will be capturing once the entire implementation is done, you will also be asked to provide a data scientist, a data analyst, so that we can start driving a lot of correlation of the data which we are getting. So these are those little things which we are trying to do. Is it institutionalized? Answer is no. But we have made a beginning. Hopefully others will follow suit and it will continue. Thanks.
In the interest of time, I think I've been told to, you know, wrap up the session by 1:15. So I'll, you know, are we open for any questions that are coming in from the audience? think that two questions only because we have overshot it by 5 minutes.
Hello. My name is Shrikant. I'm the founder of a startup called Happy Cities Labs, like Google Sidewalk.
Can you tell if you're asking this to a specific...
Yeah, I will tell. So my name is Shrikant. I'm a founder of a startup called Happy Cities Labs. We are like the Google Sidewalk Labs, but for India and growing African and Asian countries. I think a city building exercise requires strong partnerships, right, from all players, like technology providers, infrastructure, planners, and designers. Why don't we decouple these smart city projects from government and go like a private partnership of private players who are in the business of building cities and do a pilot project? I'm trying to do that. And what is your opinion on, you know, trying to decouple the truly a local self-government, you know, where they basically run the show?
No. So, you know, to be honest, I didn't understand the decoupling bit because smart cities is a government initiative on the taxpayers' money. So the projects are already government projects. But from a smart city standpoint, we do realize that it is very important to build up an ecosystem of partners. And I can talk only for the Pune smart city, where we have done reasonably well in building up a network of partners, which not only includes the academia, and academia not only from India, but even from the other developed countries. The academia is there, the startups are there, the industry participates very extensively with us. And we do keep on undertaking proof of concepts and pilots from time to time. In fact, one of the initiatives which is running at this point of time as we talk, we are developing a use case on Women's Safety Perception Index. Indian Institute of Science is our knowledge partner. And there are at least 15 different companies which are collaborating to develop that particular use case. So we do that on a regular basis, and we will continue to do that.
But that still goes through the tendering and the bureaucratic process, right? What I'm saying is for innovation to truly happen, there has to be a little bit of more, you know, free hand given to the private players to come together and then try to do a pilot project, maybe a area-based development, or maybe a, like we are trying to do something a lot of micro cities, which is roughly 9 square kilometers, 2.5 lakh population. So that kind of model, what do you think would be the response of the...
I can take that really quick. I think it's smart cities when it involves urban assets, right? Land, electricity, water. It's hard to leave the government out, frankly. I don't think anyone here is empowered to circumvent the government and give it directly to startups or vice versa. So, but I think your point is moot in that startups get access to such projects typically through SIs. And a case can be made that, you know, startups sometimes are big enough and competent enough to bid for these projects by themselves. If that's your point, I'm in agreement. I hope that it will eventually move in that direction.
Yeah, I mean, I don't necessarily mean startups, but private industry. It could be a well-established companies, infrastructure players.
So I think your point is well taken. I think yeah. No one here is at the government level where we can, you know, change policy. But
so, man, the concept that I'm trying to pitch in is till the edge of the city to provide the connectivity of water, energy, electricity, and transport and stuff like that. That could be the government responsibility. That whatever happens within that micro city could be managed within
by the private.
Yes, that's what we are trying to
work towards. I think it's moving in that direction. There's unanimity here that it's moving in that direction. But
so we are also trying.
I'm Majid, founder Khushi Gram, and working on recreating and reviving happy villages and communities. So, like he said, we work sector-wise, like cities and within cities, sub-cities. So the two major problems, clean air, as the lady who was presenting, pitching about measuring AQI. Yeah. So she talked about measuring it actually. So how can we have and integrate the startup ecosystem where we have the biggest challenge of clean air, resolve that? Because we in big cities think that we are very happy and we have got the best of it. But actually the worst air we breathe every day. Similarly for water and other most important things.
Yeah, I think frankly the two decks and presentations by Ambi and Abhilasha's company, I think they covered it in pretty good detail. I think if there's a there's a good inflection point where there's a good amount of sensors in a city or a municipality or state or country that captures data, right, in a meaningful way at a good time interval and good data, cleansed data. And that can be analyzed by a startup. That's classical innovation where layers of AI and ML will act upon data to give meaningful insights that will get consumed by government and private players from state, municipality, all the way to the central government, from insurance players, pharma companies. There'll be a lot of insights in that data will be valuable. And this part of the eco that I just spoke about is classical innovation and classical startups. That was your question.
Yeah. Just take 10 seconds more. Not just water ATMs, just to elaborate a little bit, but clean ponds within the cities that we had, or reviving the lakes. These are very key issues.
Yeah, so all those are just different infra touch points, right? Water, air, LED lights, atmosphere, vehicles, EV, mobile sharing. These are all outgrowths of the same problems and same data. Data will act upon all these problems to provide solutions.
Thank you, the panelists, to be here. Thanks, everyone. I think we'll.
I request you all to please be seated. We're just going to announce the winners from the pitching session. Meanwhile, they're doing, I would like to thank again our entrepreneur partners, TIE, TIE, Delhi, NCR, Indian Angel Network, Department of Science and Technology. We have a pavilion of Department of Science and Technology with about 20 startups in hall number 11, and Innovation Valley, Andhra Pradesh government in hall 12, and Madhya Pradesh startups as well in hall 12. I would request you all to kindly do take a round around, please. First of all, one big round of applause for all our startups who have been pitching. Thank you, everyone. All of you have been immensely great, I believe. That's why you're here today. Firstly, I would like to tell someone on the second position. I would request Mr. Vinay Chetaraju, Head Business Development, Krishnam Technologies Private Limited. He's positioned second. Sir, could Mr. Digvijay, I would request you to please present the award to the winner. It's the last session. We can give her a big round of applause, please. On the first position, we have Ms. Abhilasha Purwar, Chief Air Pollution Fighter, Blue Sky and Analytics. Congratulations, Abhilasha. Thank you, entrepreneurs. Now, I would request Mr. Digvijay to please stay on the stage. So we would like to facilitate all our fellow speakers for the second panel. Mr. Karthik Wahi, co-founder and director, Mr. Devang Mehta, partner Anthill Ventures. Mr. Manojit Bose, CKO, Pune Smart Cities. Mr. Rasik Pansare, co-founder, Get My Parking. Mr. Shashank Agrawal, Senior Associate, Sangam Ventures. And Ms. Upasana Sharma is not here. I would like Shaila Prabhu to please come on stage and take on behalf of Thai Delhi NCR. Ms. Shaila Prabhu. And I take the privilege of presenting it to Mr. Digvijay myself. Thank you, everyone. It has been a lovely session. And with this, we end our fifth Smart Cities India 2019 Expo. I hope to see you all next year. Thank you so much.